There's a call going out across the land in every nation. A call to all who swear allegiance to the cross of Christ. A call to true humility, to live our lives responsibly, to deepen our devotion to the cross at any price. Let us then be sober, moving only in the Spirit, as aliens and strangers in a hostile foreign land. The message we're proclaiming is repentance and forgiveness, the author of salvation to a dying race of men. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission, the spring from which our service overflows. Across the street or around the world, the mission's still the same. Proclaim and live the truth in Jesus' name. As a candle is consumed by the passion of the flame, spilling light unsparingly throughout a darkened room, let us burn to know him deeper than our service flaming bright. We'll radiate his passions and blaze with holy light. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission, the spring from which our service overflows. Across the street or around the world, the mission's still the same. Proclaim and live the truth in Jesus' name. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission, the spring from which our service overflows. Across the street or around the world, the mission's still the same. Proclaim and live the truth in Jesus. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission, the spring from which our service overflows. Across the street or around the world, the mission's still the same. Proclaim and live the truth in Jesus' name. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission.
Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. What an exciting day this is. The last words of great men come echoing back to us over the centuries and the millennia. But the words of the greatest man who ever lived and still lives are the words that we just read, the words of the Great Commission. And it is in celebration of that commission that we gather here this afternoon as the people of God, as friends, as family, and as partners with Stan and Mindy. What a wonderful day it is and it's my privilege to welcome you here. Would you please stand as we go before the Lord himself, who gave us that commission, Roger Dixon, chairman of the missions committee at First Baptist in Pollock Pines, comes to lead us. Roger, would you please, brother?
Let's pray. Father, we stand before you in honor and recognition of your majesty and your holiness and your purity and your grace. And we come together today to celebrate that you have elected to work through all of us, and particularly through Stan and Mindy, in a ministry and an outreach that you've chosen for them. Father, thank you for the privilege of being part of your intentions and part of your work in our world. Father, we celebrate, but we also accept a solemn responsibility to be about your work in the ways that we've heard we need to in our own community over the past couple of days, but also to be about your work in Kenya. Father, we ask you to bind us together, to do a work in our hearts, to connect us with Stan and Mindy and with you and your work in Kenya in a way that goes beyond what any of us have understood as we've come in today. Mark us and link us, vitalize us as a body focused in cooperating and just delighting in what you are doing through us, through Stan and Mindy. We bless you. We honor you. We give thanks and we make our petition in the powerful and lovely name of Christ. Amen.
I'd like to lead you in a hymn. If you'll take your bulletins, everything that we need is on here today. It's the prayer for renewal. You'll see it on the back. We're going to sing it. It's to the tune of Finlandia or Be Still My Soul. So let's join in together and sing this together. Grant us, O Lord, sing it.
Grant us, O Lord, thy grace for our renewal. Touch our dull heart with dear love. We share with thee thy boundless deep compassion for those who live and die without thee still. Oh, may I share with thee thy deep compassion for those who live and die without thee still. Grant us, O Lord, thy grace for our touch our mute lips and loosen them that we may share with men whose hearts by sin are blighted the gladsome message of thy love so free. Oh, help us share with men whose hearts are blighted the gladsome message of thy love so free. us, O Lord, thy grace for our renewal. Touch our poor faith, that we may dare for thee, that we may cast ourselves with true abandon into the strife and share thy victory. Oh, may we cast ourselves with true abandon into the strife and share thy victory.
First of all, I'd like to just thank you all for coming. It is, and I think I said this morning when we were speaking at our church, it is quite humbling and quite honestly quite overwhelming for us that you would express your support like this, because we know that many of you have come from some distance. Some of you we haven't seen in quite some time, and we genuinely appreciate your concern and support in our ministry by coming today. What I'd like to do is share a little bit about the calling that we sense the Lord has given to us, and then Mindy here is going to share in a few moments about God's confirmation of that call that has been evident in the last few months, and then a little bit later on in the time together, we're going to introduce our family and you'll get a chance to see them. Some of you haven't seen our newest addition to the family, so we'll hold her up nice and high for you to do so. You know, there's a lot that is going on in Africa these days. You hear about it in the news almost every day. You see it on the television. And it's something that has brought to our attention many things, not the least of which is the fact that Africa is in many ways, a very volatile place at this time in the history of the world. There are things going on there that we cannot really imagine here in this country. As a result of that, there have been a number of people that have said to us, you're not really still planning on going through with this, are you? Others have said, you wouldn't put your mother and father through this by going to Africa and the emotion that they will feel. And still others, well-intentioned, I should say one person who has said it on more than one occasion, has said, you know, I'm really praying for you that God would change your mind. And bless his heart, he really, really does have good intentions in that. And we understand that in some places over there is an element of danger. But, you know, our going to Africa at this point has more to do with God's calling than anything else. Now, I want to say to you that God's calling of somebody to go into a ministry is a fairly ambiguous kind of a thing. It's in some ways kind of subjective. In fact, when I was in seminary, I wrote a paper disputing the fact that there was such a thing as this kind of a call. And yet, here we are today. God's calling for us is as real to us as anything else in our lives at this point. So much so that from the moment that we made this decision together as a family, there really has not in any way been a vacillation of whether or not this was the right thing for us. We knew from the beginning, yes, we are sailing true north. This is what God wants us to do. This is what God has prepared us to do. I'd like to share with you just briefly how that came about. Part of that had to do with our simple interaction with the Word of God. I was a pastor, and I had the wonderful privilege of interacting with God's Word on a regular, consistent basis, where I could study the deep things, the various nuances and so forth of Scripture in such a way that it came alive to me, and I enjoyed that. It's a great privilege. But it also has with it a tremendous responsibility, and that is you become accountable for what you know. And what we began to be convinced of in our own minds was that God, when He revealed His Word, has a commission for all of His people that is otherworldly. By that I mean, when I came to grips with the fact that in reality, this life here is, as the Bible says, a breath. It passes swifter than a weaver's shuttle, as it says in Job. That this life is merely a preparation for our eternal life. And that God has us here for a very good reason. And that has to do with the proclamation of the gospel and the promotion of His kingdom. And that is what He wants. When we came to grips with that, when we came to grips with eternal realities such as heaven and hell and death and judgment, sure, we knew those things ever since we were this high. We studied them in Sunday school and college and seminary and all of the rest. But when we said, Lord, do I really believe that? Do I really believe that people are dying without a Savior and going to hell? That was one other thing. But all of this, our interaction with Scripture, led us to simply this. We read the Bible, but do we really believe what we're reading? And I know it sounds very simple. And it is very simple. But I have to tell you, that was the initial and major component of our calling to this kind of work, was coming to grips with what the Bible says about reality itself. The second thing in our calling had to do with the fact that Mindy and I began very intensely praying that God would give us His mind and His heart. That's a very generic prayer. It is one that we all pray, but maybe we were unprepared for the fact that God began to answer that prayer. And He began to give us His heart and put on our hearts the things that are on His heart. And what is on God's heart? It's the same thing that has always been on God's heart. For God so loved the world that He gave. He was compelled by a love that we will never fully understand to do something that we can never fully comprehend, to give His Son. And He began to put the world on our heart. And when I say the world, I'm talking in a more global sense. He began to show us various needs and opportunities around the world so that our hearts were drawn to those people and those places where there were acute needs. Not to say that there aren't acute needs here, there are. But we felt that those needs in those places, some of those places were drawing us there. And then the third thing had to do with simply objectively evaluating our own gifts and desires and the personalities even that God had given to Mindy and myself and our family. It was really through objectively evaluating those things, my pastoral gifts, Mindy's hospitality gifts and other gifts that she has, and all of these kinds of things come together, we began to see, you know, there really is a match there. so that when God showed us opportunities and needs throughout the world, particularly in areas where we felt that our gifts would be something that could respond to some of those things, we said, yes, that fits. It's something that we are excited about and something that we want to prepare for and to pursue. I've been very general here and not real specific, but I wanted to just do that to share with you that our calling to this particular ministry has been something that the Lord has, I believe, given to us. It's not something that we have contrived and manufactured through some spirit of adventure or something else. It is something that has to do with a desire to do what is on His heart. In closing, just before Mindy speaks here, we have, and I mentioned this in the service this morning at Pollock Pines, we have adopted a verse that has, from the very beginning, even before we even thought of going to Africa, but in our times of praying about our ministry, has become our philosophy of ministry and our desire and prayer to God for our own lives. And it goes like this. This is Paul speaking in Thessalonians, and he says about he and Silas, "We loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well, because you had become so dear to us." I believe that God has given us a sense of love and compassion for a people that we have never met before, and people that in our natural minds and in our natural way of thinking, we just don't have that kind of love for them. In fact, there's sort of a resistance or an opposition toward that, but it's God that has done that, and that is the verse that has really been a motivating factor for us.
In thinking about what has confirmed our decisions over and over, we are overwhelmed by the amount of confirmation that God has given to us. And I just want to share a little bit of that with you, because I think it's just exciting to see the plan that He has laid out so clearly for us, that a verse that has become important to me that talks about shrinking back in Hebrews, I dare not shrink back because of these confirmations that I hold on to of His plan. The first is the missionaries that came to visit us, the Riggins, and they called us and they bugged us about just coming and paying us this little visit so that, you know, they could try to talk us into going with them with Africa Inland Mission. And I remember saying to Stan, "Oh, I don't want them to come, you know." And all right, we'll have them over for dinner, and that'll be the end of it. And it was with that attitude that I accepted them into our home. Both of us kind of had that same attitude. And there was nothing outstanding about their personalities. There was nothing charismatic or drawing necessarily about them as individuals, except for the Spirit of God within them that was very different than anything I had experienced in people. And they presented the need of the people in Africa, and we both knew that after they ended up staying, of course, long into the night, and we enjoyed our time so much with them. And the minute they left, we knew that was the direction we were going to go, and that was after months of being in limbo land, so to speak. And so that was the first confirmation. Shortly after that, I became pregnant. And if anyone would have told me that I would have a baby and plan to go to Africa in the same span of time, I would have said never, never would that work. And it was just exciting again to see and learn about the Indian people that we are going to, what a bridge Carly Blue will be in this whole relationship building time. And again, God's timing on this has just been unbelievable to me. It's just a blessing. She is a blessing that already in some of my experiences proves that she's going to be a relationship builder. Another one was the orientation school that we went to back in New York. And we were there 3 weeks. And at that time, we weren't really sure which direction we were going to go. But at the end of those 3 weeks, there was so much affirmation and confirmation of both of our gifts. And one particular affirmation that stood out to me, because it's probably at the heart of my desires, and that was regarding our family and our own little nuclear family here. And people were just amazed at the love that they saw within our little unit. And it was not like that with all the missionaries that were back there. There were people that obviously did not enjoy their children, did not enjoy one another. And I think the strength of being best friends and the strong marriage God has given us, the strong love and enjoyment we have with our children, that one lady said, your children are going to do so well over there because they are so secure in their love. And somebody else said, the love that you demonstrate just within your family, that is unusual, and it will stand out as unusual over there. Not that they don't love their children, but there was something that was pointed out to us as unique. And that came from singles, that came from older ladies, that came from every walk of life, college people. And it was just kind of neat to have that affirmed, especially, like I said, it's something that's so dear to me. Another thing at orientation school was Stan's leadership abilities and his pastoral skills. And they recognized that. It's just interesting how that progressed while we were back there. In some sense, he became the pastor of the group for a while, and that was out of 100 people. And it just was another affirmation that, yes, this was a sense of sailing true north. Our family support. I do not take it for granted, and neither of us do, that our families have been very supportive of us. This is not, as you can imagine, real easy for all of them to let us go away for 4 years. It's definitely hard for us, but there's that twist of pain in them that they definitely feel, but there's these open-handedness that lets us go freely, and that is not to be taken for granted. And the emotional and every other kind of support that they are providing sends us out so much stronger because they are behind us. The church support. I cannot tell you how dear, like I expressed this morning, the church has become to us. I realize we cannot do this without you. I realize that in the deepest parts of my heart. And up to a year and a half or 2 years ago, like I've shared before, and I'm sorry this is somewhat redundant for some of you who have heard our story over and over, but I think it bears repeating because it's just a truth that means so much to me. We were in limbo as far as how we felt about church and where we felt we were going to fit in. And I am just so excited about how dear, specifically the church in Pollock Pines has become to us, but the church at large here, the body of Christ. And I can honestly say that your faces, I might not even know all of your names, but your faces stay in my mind, and I'm thankful for you, and realize I could not be doing this without the dear support that you have put behind us. Along kind of with that, it's not just been an emotional uplifting and a support in spiritual ways and every other way, but financially, If anyone, I really didn't think we were going to Africa in June because I thought there is no way that we will raise $20,000. That figure is just like the most amount of money I've thought of for anything in my life. And we'll never get that all together. We'll never get the $3,300 a month that we need. And to see that in 8 months that has been done, I cannot shrink back from the fact that God wants us there at the timing that he wants us there. There's just too many horror stories that this drags on for people for 3-4 years at a time, and then it's just barely getting by. We go out with such a strong base, and we have many, many of you to thank for that. Many churches in this area as well, and it's a very neat feeling to know that we have come not only to love one church in this area, but feel very connected with many churches, and it's neat to see so many of you from a bunch of the churches in this area. And one last thing that I just can't ignore is the fact that Carly Blue has such a wonderful, easygoing personality. This weekend would be a real good example of, we've been going like a million miles an hour, and she just goes with the flow and is someone who is so adaptable and so gracious in her little spirit. Now she'll start to scream any minute, I know, but she's, you know, that there's so much of this that would have been a real trial, you know, this deputation time, having a newborn baby. And again, she's kind of only served as a bridge in bringing this all together. And I can't take that for granted. The boys were never bad babies, but they certainly weren't as easygoing as she is. And it's just another, might seem small, but it's the kind of things that could really leave you frazzled. And I thank God that he's given us this new little person to focus on, and that she has such an agreeable personality that makes life pretty easy. I haven't memorized that verse quite as clearly as Stan, but I just want to read it one more time to you that he quoted a minute ago, because to me, it's where my heart is also, and it means the most to me. And I want to say it not for the people right now that we are going to, but I want to say this to you. We loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well, because you have become so dear to us.
I would like to read from the Apostle Paul. He wrote to his son Timothy. These words are applicable for this occasion. So do not be ashamed to testify about our Lord, or ashamed to testify, or ashamed of me, his prisoner, but join with me in suffering for the gospel by the power of God, who has saved us and called us to a holy life. Not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given to us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. And of this gospel, I was appointed a herald, an apostle, and a teacher. That is why I am suffering as I am, yet I am not ashamed, because I know whom I have believed, and am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him for that day. What you have heard from me, keep as a pattern of sound teaching with faith and love in Christ Jesus. Guard the good deposit that was entrusted to you. Guard it with the help of the Holy Spirit who lives in us. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you made your good confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the sight of God, who gives life to everything, and of Christ Jesus, who while testifying before Pontius Pilate, made the good confession, I charge you to keep this command without spot or blame until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which God will bring about in his own time. God, the blessed and only ruler, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone is immortal and who lives in unapproachable light, whom no one has seen or can see, to him be honor and might forever.
Yes. I'm supposed to tell you what Stan and Mindy will be encountering out there. It looks like a jungle, doesn't it? This is the city of Nairobi with more than 2 million people. For some reason, this little instrument that I've been given is not working. Main streets that you see in town, for those of you who were concerned about them being hit by buffaloes and lions, their greater concern should be being hit by cars, of which has happened to me 5 times. The countryside just in the city of Nairobi, very beautiful. Don't feel too sorry for them. And don't call AAA when you get in some of the roads out there. Maybe I should tell you to just, for some reason, gentlemen, this is not working, so I will just ask you next, okay? And then you just proceed to the next slide. Okay, next. We need another slide, if it's possible. You see, I firmly believe that the devil has certain demons assigned to audiovisual equipment. Okay. This looks like Mombasa Road, some of the typical sunsets you would see there. Next, please. Next. Here's a gentleman that's in the Jain temple, ringing a bell to summon the attentions of the god. It's really sad to realize that there are people who worship a religion that have a god that's so impersonal that they have to try to get his attention in order to commune with him. Next. Here's a gentleman offering flowers. These flowers are sold outside the temple. If they so much as smell them, they're no longer worthy of being offered to the idols. Next. This is inside the Sikh Gurdwara. Sikhism is one of the religions there that Stan and Mindy will also be encountering as they work among the Indians there. Next. This is Rabi, one of the priests at the Hare Krishna temples. I studied Hinduism under 5 Hindu priests there, and Rabi was one of them. Next. Islam also is a religion that we worked within. Here's a soul worshiper in the mosque there in Nairobi seeking solace from Allah. Next. This is a wax statue of A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, who is the founder of the Hare Krishna movement. You'll find his wax figures in Hindu temples, Hare Krishna temples around the world. You walk into this temple here and the power of Satan is overwhelming. We have had people that have gotten ill regurgitating in the parking lot before they even arrived at the building. The power of Satan and demons are so strong within the religion of Hinduism because everything that they do is demonically orchestrated. Every idol that they have goes through an installation ceremony from 3 to 5 days of praying the demons to inhabit the idols that they have there. Next. Here's a gentleman that's praying to Goddess Amba. There's over 330 million gods and goddesses in Hinduism, and if you think about that, that's more than one per person for everyone who lives in the United States. Next. You notice the tiger behind there. For every form of good within Hinduism, there is also a form of terror. Next. Here is a Jain priest that's cleaning the gods there, and if you'll notice the mask on his face, that is all pure marble, white marble, and what you see there is silver and gold, are silver and gold leaves They're pure silver and gold that people pay to have them put on the gods. The priest here does not so much as want to even contaminate those gods and goddesses with his breath. Next. This is Ganesh. He is the elephant-headed god of wisdom. Makes me very much concerned about the wisdom of Hinduism. Next. Do you notice the picture in the middle? Jesus Christ is worshipped among the Hindus, added simply to the pantheon of gods and goddesses, worshipped as a good person, a good man. It is this Jesus that I'm able to go into the temples. I was pastor of the church. We founded the church, for those of you who do not know. We were the pastor in founding the church there in Nairobi, Kenya, where Stan and Mindy are going to be ministering. And it was in these temples that God gave us liberty to be able to proclaim to them the truth of this person that they had, or the picture at least, hanging in their temple. Next. The church, Fellowship Bible Church. This is a wonderful sight, isn't it? To see people come from the darkness of Hinduism and in Islam, coming together in a congregation, worshiping and praising God. Next. This is our second missions conference within the church there. And the first year that we planted the church, we had our first missions conference. And to date, we've had more than 10 missionaries go out of that church to places around the world. Next. These are some of the gentlemen friends of mine. All of them are Hindus there, but this is at one of our missions conference. Can you imagine having Muslims and Hindus and Sikhs coming to a missions conference? Next. This is a women's Bible study in our backyard. That is Khatun Patel there standing in the front. She is a former Muslim. Next. This is a businessmen's lunch and lecture. God gave us the privilege of establishing a relationship with 71 families within the unreached community of businessmen in Nairobi. And we had a luncheon lecture in our church there where Sabod Sahu, one of our friends there, preached a message to them entitled, Why Christ Died. At the end of that message, more than 30 of those men there responded in a card which they were to fill out that it was the first time ever in their lives that they had heard the gospel. Next. Every 3 months, we have evangelistic picnics in the park where we fix food together as a church and then invite Indians from friends from all over the city. It's not only a time of friendship, but it's also a time of evangelism where the gospel is shared and testimonies of Christian or of converts is also given. Next. Bible studies in the home. Next. These are one of the couples. The first missionaries that went out of our church, Stanley and Ramola Aaron, were Hindus and came to know the Lord. They came forward in our first missions conference, gave their lives to the Lord for full-time Christian service. Our little church out there sent them to India for 4 years of college. They now are working among Hindus in Toronto, the first missionaries out of our church. By the way, their support was fully given by the church there. No mission money has gone into that church in supporting the missionaries there. It's all from this congregation. Next. Mustana Mustali Mamuji. Well, the writing is backwards there, but I could tell you it was Gujarati, and you probably wouldn't figure it out. But these gentlemen here were Muslims. They were born on the same day and born again on the same day without each other knowing it. They came down to breakfast one morning, each having their own room, and Mustan said to Mustali, you better sit down. I've got something to tell you. And Mustali said to Muslim, no, I've got something to tell you that's going to be even worse. You better sit down. And as they begin arguing back and forth who was going to speak first, well, one of them says, I just want you to know that last night I gave my heart to the Lord Jesus Christ and accept him as my Savior. The other did the same. Right now, these two gentlemen are missionaries with Evangelism Explosion. They travel around the world teaching people how to witness to Muslims. This one of them was my chairman of the deacons, and the other was the chairman of our missions committee. Next. These women here, the one on the right has probably led more souls to the Lord out there in Nairobi among the Indian community than anyone I've known. The second from the right, Fozia Mamuji, as her pastor when we left Kenya, she came to the States to work with us here, and she and her husband now are on their way to Siberia to work among Muslims there. The one next to her in the black in the middle, her name is Afra. Afra finished her degree in missions at Columbia Bible College and started a Christian daycare center and nursery in Canada, reaching into the Indian community with the love of Christ through children. And the one to the there in the red, her name is Sherry. She is now the pastor's wife of that church. Next. Obviously, you can see the church there gathered around as baptism is held in the city pool. We have a great congregation around at that time because they kick everybody out of the pool so we can baptize. Next. There is a lady. She came to know the Lord. She was a Sikh, and she and her three children came to Christ. Her husband sent three thugs to kill her and the children one night. And one of my deacons and I had to come to their assistance with ball bats to drive these guys away, to keep them from being killed. They lived with us for some time, and her husband later came to my house and put a pistol to my head to kill me. We were standing in the front yard, and he said, "I'm going to blow your brains out." And I looked at him, and I said, "Rom, if you're going to shoot me, please don't shoot me here. Let's go behind the house, and you can shoot me there." And he looked at me and he says, "You know, you're crazy." And I said, "Well, I'm not the one with the gun." And he had no intentions of shooting me. He just wanted to scare me. Ram threw his gun down in the car. He left. And it was about 6 or 8 months later, Ram prayed the prayer to receive Jesus Christ as his Savior and Lord. Next. This is Sunil, the pastor, on the day that he was baptized. A former Hindu convict that Jesus Christ grabbed a hold of his heart and life and has turned him into a fantastic pastor and brother in the Lord. He will be leading, he's the pastor of the church and will be leading part of the team there in Nairobi that Stan and Mindy will be working with. Next. This is Sunil behind the pulpit there. Next. I'm sorry, next. Ladies in the temple there. Next. Here's a lady that's fanning some of the smoke into the face of this child. Yet another generation being drawn into Hinduism and being lost. It's to this vision. I want you to remember this as Stan and Mindy are going to be going out there to be able to do what they can to see these people come to know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. Next. Okay, could I have the lights, please? I thought it might be helpful to you to give you just a few glimpses of the area and what's going on there. But I want to just very briefly, in the couple of moments that I have remaining, share with you a couple of things. One of the greatest obstacles that they're going to face in relationship to Hinduism is the intellectual and the philosophical challenge of Hinduism. It reminds me of a passage of scripture. You see, within Hinduism, they worship 330 million gods and goddesses, and every religion is included as a part of Hinduism. They believe in relative truth. But you see, when one believes in relative truth, one also, if they're honest with their own beliefs and understanding, they must also believe in relative error. Because there can be no absolute truth if one believes in relative truth. And this is one of the greatest difficulties working among Hindus, because they are not sincere seekers. They are not sincere even in their own beliefs. You see, one can be an atheist and be a Hindu, And one can believe in 330 million gods and goddesses and be a Hindu. Trying to define Hinduism is sort of like trying to nail Jell-O to the wall. It has form, has substance, but there's nothing there to hold its shape. It conforms to anything that it would fill. And it's unfortunate that people in America today, even as I studied Hinduism and saw many virtues within the beliefs of Hinduism, but many people today remind me, as is said in the book of Romans, that professing themselves to be wise, they became as fools. It's unfortunate today that the New Age movement is falling into the trap of Hinduism. The New Age movement is nothing but Hinduism in new clothes, just as the transcendental meditation was before, just as Bhagwan Rajneesh was before during those days. But in relationship to the scripture, we don't have relative truth. We have absolute and eternal truth. It's for this reason that the world indeed is lost in sin without a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us in Colossians chapter 2, it says, I want you to know how much I am struggling for you, as he writes to the church, and for those in Laodicea, and for all who have not met me personally. My purpose is that they may be encouraged in heart and united in love, so that they may have the full richness of complete understanding, in order that they may know the mystery of God, namely Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I tell you this so that no one may deceive you by fine-sounding arguments. For though I am absent from you in the body, I am present with you in spirit and delight to see how orderly you are and how firm your faith in Christ is. So then, just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you are taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. See to it that no one should take you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the basic principles of this world rather than on Christ. For in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and you have been given fullness in Christ, who is the head over every power and authority. Remember and claim this passage of scripture for Stan and Mindy, as they will be encountering the forces of Satan, who has so twisted and blinded the minds of men, not just there, but all over the world, who believe in this trap of intellectual and philosophical assent. That's one of the greatest struggles that they will have. You see, Hinduism, if you're a Hindu and you're wrong in this life, you have 1,399,000 more chances to get it right. Because within Hinduism, they believe that you can be reincarnated 1,400,000 times. I asked some of the priests which reincarnation they were on as I was learning from them, and they laughed and scolded me. They have no idea. But you see, our Bible tells us that it's appointed once to man, and it's appointed once unto man to die, and after that the judgment. You see, we only get one chance. And to the Hindu, if I am wrong and Hinduism is right, I have still 1,399,999 chances to get it right. But if they are wrong, and Jesus is in fact who he says he is, they are wrong for eternity. They need to know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. Representing the Africa Inland Mission, I would like to thank you for your part in training these two people that are going out to work among us. I want to assure you, on behalf of our mission, of our responsibility being fulfilled and doing all that we can to handle them well on your behalf. to encourage them in times when they need encouragement, to be tender toward them as they are learning and experiencing new things on the field. And we want you to know that we will do everything that we possibly can in partnershiping with you to help you see your vision fulfilled for world evangelism through these servants of yours that you're sending to work with us. In closing, I'd like to speak to the family, those of you that are here. I'd like to point your attention to Numbers chapter 13. It was a time when the children of Israel were coming out of Egypt, and they were told by God to go in and possess the land at Kadesh Barnea. And there were those that were sent to spy out the land, and they came back talking of giants and all kinds of things. They talked about good things as well as bad. It came to a place when they were giving the report, and one of the things that they were talking about as they were giving that report, it says, if I can... chapter 14. Well, I'm embarrassed here. I brought up the wrong Bible. But let me just tell you what it said. In that passage of Scripture, the ones who were giving the bad report, one of the things that they said as a reason for not entering into the land is they said that they were afraid of what would happen to their women and children. You see, it's never, ever right for us to model disobedience. When we have clear direction of the Lord, God will never bless us when we walk in disobedience for whatever reason and model disobedience to our family. It matters not if you're concerned about your family. We all should be. But the worst thing that we can do is to live in disobedience. You see what happened then, because the children of Israel did not go in and possess the land, because of the fear that the fathers had and the disobedience to God, the fathers died in the wilderness, and the battle then had to be fought by the children, that the fathers were fearful of being hurt. You see, Stan and Mindy must go because God has given them clear direction. And the thing that you would not want to happen is that Stan and Mindy would model disobedience before their children. Because if they do not step out in faith and obedience to God now, it will be their children and their family that will suffer as well as them. So in that sense, be joyful for them that they indeed are walking in obedience to the Lord Jesus Christ in their calling, and I affirm you in that. Thank you.
We're going to give you an opportunity to stand and sing one more hymn that appears on the back of your program. Stand together. Stand. To the tune of How Great Thou Art, the song Until They Know. Let's sing it together.
Oh, when I think of all the many millions who do not know the sound of thy sweet name, who do not know the miracle of Calvary, who never can thy great salvation claim, then cries my heart, oh, teach me, Lord, to care until they know how great thou art. Then to care until they know how great thou art. Oh, when I think of all the heathen idols, these lifeless gods just made of wood and stone, and when I think of people calling to them, deaf ears that cannot hear the heartsick groan, then cries my heart, oh, make us go and tell of Jesus who we love so well. Then cries my heart, oh, make us go and tell of Jesus who we love so well. But when they know that Jesus died to save them, and when they know the grace he can impart, when Jesus shines his love divine within them, when he transforms their sinful darkened heart, then shall sing my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then thee shall sing my Savior God to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Be seated. It
is my very happy assignment to be able to give a charge to Stan and Mindy and to the congregation who is sending them forth unto the place of God's calling. Before I do that, I want to say just a word to the significant members of Stan and Mindy's family. Hannah prayed fervently for a son, and God granted that prayer, and she felt that Samuel ever and always was alone. And when he was weaned, she took him to Shiloh and put him into the care of Eli the priest. And this is what she said: "For this boy I prayed, and the Lord has given me my petition, which I ask of him. So I have dedicated him to the Lord." As long as he lives, he is dedicated to the Lord. And he worshiped the Lord there. With that loan, she loaned Samuel to the Lord who gave him. And then she sat back and collected the interest on the loan. And so will you. She saw Samuel four times in four years. Once a year, she made a robe, each year a little bigger than the last, and went to the sacrifice at Shiloh, where each year she saw her son. You, as members of the family, will ever and always collect the interest on the loan that you've made to God in the person of your children. And for that, you must give him thanks and everlasting praise. I want to share ever so briefly with you a passage out of the 13th chapter of the book of Acts. Now there were at Antioch in the church that was there prophets and teachers: Barnabas, Simeon, who was called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Menaean, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. And while they were ministering to the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." Then when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. I believe that there are three elements here that characterize most of the missionary enterprise, at least as I've come to know it. The separation of the missionary, the summons of the Holy Spirit, and the sending of the church. There will be a separation for these missionaries. The Spirit of God said, "Separate me now those whom I have called." For Stan and Mindy, there will be a separation from family, from friends, from a beloved fellowship, and from the familiar. But I must remind you that what is strange and new and untried is no surprise to him whom you follow. I read in the Word that when he sets forth or sends forth his sheep, he goes before them. He will have preceded you to Nairobi, and as here, you will find him in a new relationship there. Years ago, a man in our church who had flown with the Royal Canadian Air Force in World War II wished to fly for the Lord and kept applying for Missionary Aviation Fellowship. He was in his 30s and considered to be too old. They kept putting his application in the wastebasket, but there came a day when they became desperate for pilots. And they called our friend and said, "We have a place for you," and they sent him to Shelmera in Ecuador, from whence the missionaries to the Aucas had gone. He wrote a letter back during those days to his pastor and said, "Pastor, I had the strangest experience the other day. I stood on the airstrip here in Shelmera." And he said, a great sense of desolation swept over me that I'd never felt before in my entire life. He said, "Everything that was familiar to me was gone. The church, the singing, the preaching, everything I had come to know and love, all of a sudden was no longer there." And he said, "I felt such a great sense of loss." But he said, "I've never come to know God in a deeper way than I know him now, when all the props were removed and all the familiar was taken away, and I was caused to seek the source of my life, of my ministry, and of my service in a new way, and I was not disappointed, and God richly blessed. So there will be separation, no doubt of that. Because there is a summon of the Holy Spirit. Separate me now, Paul and Barnabas, to the work to which I have called them. He has summoned them, and you've heard their testimony of their faithful obedience to that summons. It carries with it all the reward and the blessing that only God can give. I remember a missionary song from my youth, and the one in the book, they changed the words. I really don't know why. Maybe they thought that these words were better suited to the pith helmet era of missions, that these things just don't happen anymore. And even though you didn't see pictures tonight of the bush, but of a rather modern-looking city, the sentiment here has characterized the heart and the soul of missionaries and missions from the very beginning, and I want to read it to you. It's found in the lovely song, So Send I You. So send I you to labor unrewarded, to serve unpaid, unloved, unsought, unknown, to bear rebuke, to suffer scorn and scoffing. So send I you to toil for me alone. So send I you to bind the bruised and broken, or wandering souls to work, to weep, to wake, to bear the burdens of a world aweary. So send I you to suffer for my sake. So send I you to loneliness and longing, with heart a hungering for the loved and known, forsaking home and kindred, friend and dear one. So send I you to know my love alone. So send I you to leave your life's ambition, to die to dear desire, self-will resign, to labor long and love where men revile you. So send I you to lose your life in mine. So send I you to hearts made hard by hatred, to eyes made blind because they will not see, to spend, though it be blood, to spend and spare not, so send I you to taste of Calvary. As the Father has sent me, even so send I you. There is a summons of the Holy Spirit, and there is a sending by the church. When they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. Accompanied by your prayers, your constant and daily intercession before the Father, your fellowship through correspondence, your remembrances of those who are part of you in a faraway land, send them forth, as I know you do, in love and in promise of constant reminder that their names will be heard in the court of heaven by the ear of the sender, by those who share in the fellowship of the sent. Our Father, we are so grateful that in order that others may hear, some must go. And there is a separation that some of us have balked at over the years. being comfortable to stay close to the shore and not launch out where waters are deep. But, oh God, these are waters to swim in, sustained by thy love and grace. We pray, Father, that in that separation, there may be a great sense renewed daily of the summons of the Spirit of the living God, and that no place on earth could they be more safe than in the center of thy will. And Father, for this sending congregation, bless them. May they feel a sense of responsibility, and when the word comes back of the blessing of God, those far away and those at home shall rejoice together, and heaven will sing when it is reported that men and women have come to Christ as Savior. Thank you, Father, in our Lord's dear name. Amen.
At this time, we come to that which is perhaps the most solemn moment of our gathering. It's a time that we've set aside for the expression of a covenant. A covenant is a binding agreement between parties of like mind. This is an opportunity for us as a congregation to affirm Stan and Mindy, to express our unanimity in that affirmation, and to express as well that continuing support that Pastor Toms has made reference to. I invite you to take your bulletin, to look inside of it, and you will find an insert that is marked Covenant. I'd like to ask you to stand. I am going to read, and then if you as a congregation would respond with an amen as the symbol of your agreement. We, the family and friends and partners together in the kingdom of God, do hereby recognize and joyfully affirm the call of God upon the Myers family in missionary service.
We, the Myers family, acknowledge that call and joyfully accept the privilege and responsibility of representing Jesus Christ as missionaries. Amen.
As partners in your ministry, we pledge to faithfully pray for each of you, Stan, Mindy, James, Lucas, and Carly Blue, for spiritual growth and development, physical and emotional health, seasons of refreshment and fun, blessing in ministry, and deep and satisfying relationships. Congregation, amen.
We pledge to faithfully pray for this community of believers, for your spiritual vitality and your impact upon this community for Jesus' sake. Amen.
We covenant to be a source of encouragement to you through consistent and clear communication, to reaffirm our partnership in your ministry, and to express God's work in our lives. Amen.
And we also covenant to be a source of encouragement to you through consistent and clear communication, to reaffirm our partnership in your ministry and to express God's work in our lives.
Amen.
We further commit ourselves, as God enables, to provide for your financial needs in order that God's work through you be free of needless anxiety. Amen.
And we pledge to be prudent and wise stewards of the finances that you, in the providence and prompting of God, have entrusted to us. On behalf of our family, we would like to present the church with this gift as a reminder of our ministry and a reminder to pray for us.
On behalf of the church, I most gladly receive this gracious and beautiful reminder of the country to which God has called you, into the ministry that we all pray that God will bless in the greatest way. Archie and I would like to present to you, as a representative of the African Inland Mission, and I as a representative of the First Baptist Church of Pollock Pines, a certificate of commissioning that commemorates this great day under the Holy Spirit of God. I share with you the verbiage of that commissioning certificate. Be it known that Stan and Mindy and their children have been commissioned and duly set apart for the Ministry of Missionary Service by the First Baptist Church of Pollock Pines to serve under the Africa Inland Mission with all of the honors and privileges appertaining thereto. We have as well one other symbol of our love. This is intended to be a guest book for your home. It's to remind you of the home that always is here for you, a home not only in this geographical area, but a home in our hearts. To remind you as well, as you share hospitality with others, that the Lord Jesus has been hospitable to all of us, in that he takes up residence in our hearts and allows us the privilege to introduce others to that home that there is in him. May you be refreshed many, many times as those who come through your home experience the love of Jesus. God bless you. At this time, I would like to ask for a number of other pastors who are both friends and from the area and outside the area to come and to join with us in a commissioning prayer. If, gentlemen, you would come at this time. There's something that we're going to do in just a moment, that is to gather around Stan and Mindy and the children and to lay hands upon them. That is an expression of identification in the Old Testament. The people of God lay hands upon the altar as a symbol of their identifying with that sacrifice for their sin. In the New Testament, that principle of identification, that practice, what carried over in the ordaining and the commissioning of those in special causes of ministry. The Apostle Paul told the young Timothy to lay hands suddenly on no man. This is by no means a sudden laying on of hands. It comes under the determinate leading of the Holy Spirit. It comes after great evidence of God's call and God's blessing. And it is a joy for us as ministers of the gospel to stand here and to identify with our brother, and really to stand here on your behalf as the people of God, to identify with them in this ministry that God has called them to. As well, joining us and leading off will be Tim. And Tim is coming as the chairman of the board at Pollock Pines, Tim Field, and he represents the body in a very special way, in that it is not possible for all of us to gather around and to lay hands upon them. I'd like to invite you to move to the center of the aisle and to join hands with one another as an expression of our unanimity, as an expression of our unity in this. Gentlemen, would you please come?
Pray. Our Heavenly Father, it's a joyful delight to understand that, unlike the Hindus, we need not loudly ring a gong or a bell to get your attention. And Lord, that as opposed to having millions of gods, we have one true God that has revealed himself to us. Lord, for that we give you praise. And not only that we can get your attention and that we can know you, but Lord, we understand that you are actively and vitally involved in our lives, preparing the paths before us, leading and guiding, even before we seek your will. And Father, for that I give thanks for the testimony from Stan and Mindy tonight of how you worked in their lives, bringing events and hearts and many things together to give them a clear call to your mission field. And then, Lord, that you have provided substantial reinforcement of that call, Lord, so that as they go out in true confidence, not divided or uncertain, but proudly and strongly proclaiming your direction for them. Father, on behalf of the First Baptist Church of Pollock Pines, I commit our body to pray for them and to lift them up to you. Lord, tonight, I would just pray for this family. Father, that even now you would be gathering your angels of protection around them, that as they go out into the mission field, Lord, that they would be safe, not only from physical harm, but from spiritual harm, Lord, within this family unit, that you would keep Satan's evil grasp away from them, Lord, that they might grow in their love for each other and their joy in you so closely that Satan has no way to gain a foothold into their lives. So, Father, that would be my prayer tonight. And we just thank you for this time that we could be a part of sending them out. In Jesus' name I pray.
Heavenly Father, we know that your promise is the word of God to go with wherever we go. And I commit Stan and Mindy to you and pray that they might experience your going with them, that your power is there to lead and to direct. We want to claim that power to be upon them. Not that they are adequate in themselves, but their adequacy is in you. We send them forth by your power to preach the gospel to people who need it so desperately. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Father, it's a joy just to be a part of your kingdom and to see what you've done in this family and in this congregation, this community. Father, our hearts are moved. to see such a great thing. Father, to see your provision. Lord, we ask your blessing upon these people. May you bless them with reward for their harvest as they minister. Father, as they endeavor to plant a church, may it be accomplished. As they endeavor to win souls for Christ, may you drive away the blindness, Lord, that Satan might cause, and the light of the glory of the gospel would shine into hearts. And Father, I want to pray for their children. Lord, may they grow, these two young boys, may they grow to love you. Lord, may they be strong, mighty in their spirit, strong in their inner man. Father, would you make them gentle and lowly in heart, even as the Lord Jesus was, and yet bold, Lord. And Father, for little Carly Blue, Lord, may you instill into her heart a gentle and quiet spirit that is so precious in your sight. Father, I thank you for Stan and Mindy, the example they've been to us as they ministered among us and just lived among us. And Father, bless them, protect them. The enemy would want to bring their downfall. Father, may you not allow it. Even as you hedged Job and protected him, may you do that for the Myers family, Lord. Oh, we've been told that the enemy is strong where they're going, Lord. May they know a special anointing of your spirit, that the word of God might go forth in power through their ministry. And Father, we'll give you glory when we see that happening. We pray in Jesus' name.
Eternal Heavenly Father, our gathering this evening is to witness you exercising your sovereign right to interfere in our lives and to cause us to change direction. Father, we don't always understand the way in which you move, but it's with an abandoned faith that Stan and Mindy look and trust you, look to you and seek your guidance in the way that they should go. And in being able and to be a part of this, we have been invited also to see your glory at work. For that is the primary reason we gather and the primary reason you are sending them. Father, also you're sending them to speak the truth, which is a minority over there. It's very shallow. And we pray that this whole experience for Stan and Mindy might remind them that they are to speak the truth boldly as well as in love, that they are to take the people deep into the scriptures, that they are to realize that they are not simply leading people in conversion, but helping establishing the church for future generations. And we pray that what might happen there will go much deeper than what we are experiencing at this moment in our own land. We also pray, Heavenly Father, that you would give them sensitive hearts, that they might knit with those who at this moment are so rebellious against you, who are haters of the gospel and know not Christ. Father, we do also pray that for Mindy, especially as she seeks to work with the women there, that you would give her a sense of compassion for they don't have the same sort of freedoms as women in our own land, and that she might understand that and at the same time be able to minister in that sort of setting and culture. Bless the boys, Father, we pray, for all that will be so unfamiliar to them. We hope, Lord, is something that's going to turn their hearts closer to you. And Father, we ask, Lord, that as ascending church and as the parents of Stan and Mindy, that we might be able to send them by letting go, opening our hands, and once again recognizing that it's because you have chosen to do this. It's your right, you are sovereign. And we pray that we might understand and obey and glorify your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our Heavenly Father, we love Stan and Mindy, but we understand that thou dost love them infinitely more. And we pray, dear God, that as they go, they shall know the abundance of that love and the abounding nature of thy grace. And thou would make provision for every needful good in their lives. Make them, Father, to be effective instruments of the Spirit of God. And under the proclamation of truth, open hearts and minds and lives to the gospel of Christ. And we shall give thee praise and thanks in the Savior's dear name.
Dear Lord, we are thankful for the parents who help raise Stan, and for their willingness to be an example and to raise him in this church and to see that he came to know you. And Lord, it's a difficult thing to see your son go to a different country. And we praise you for the separation that has taken place. As was said, it was separated by the Holy Spirit. And that the same Spirit that guides Jim and Janice guides their son and their daughter-in-law and their family. And Lord, as was prayed earlier, we do pray for the Spirit to go ahead of Stan and Mindy and to prepare the hearts of people they're going to be working with, because the driving force, Lord, is we know they are in darkness. We know there are people that are going to a Christless eternity. And we know that what they bring is not another religion, but the light of God to them. And so, Lord, as they go, we ask that the Spirit of God would strengthen them, sustain them, empower them, and go before them, that it would drive out the darkness of some of the lives that have been captured by the enemy for so long. We ask, Lord, that we would be faithful in praying for them, in supporting them, in remembering them before your throne and financially as well. And that the words that come back from Stan and Mindy, as the psalmist said, will be like a water to a thirsty heart as we hear of the ministry that they have. So bless them and keep them, Lord, for we ask this in Christ's name.
Father, in representing the church to whom they will go, the people for whom they already have been able to feel and sense in their hearts a love, I thank you that you have hand-chosen these servants to send to us, to bring us to a knowledge of your Son, to disciple us in the faith, to help us to grow, to help remove from our minds and our hearts the centuries and millenniums of a faith that has so intertwined our thoughts and thinking, that it is only through the divine gardener that those weeds can be extracted without damaging us. We thank you that you've chosen very wisely those that are very much like our own temperament, that are slow to speak, that are full of love, that seek true wisdom and knowledge, that have a heart of compassion for those who indeed are in need. God, we thank you as a people for sending this family that we too can pour out your love upon, that we also can meet their needs as brothers and sisters in Christ to help fill the loneliness at times, the need for companionship. Thank you for giving us a privilege of being able to minister to them as well as a part of our family, as a part of our body. We thank you for their dedication and faith in you of being able to submit themselves to be obedient to a people that they've never seen, to a country they've never been, to a church they've never served. Thank you. We thank you too for the churches that love you enough, that an expression of that love is that they would send these to us. God, we do thank you and praise you for every prayer that's prayed, not just on their behalf, but ours as well, as we too need prayers of God's people to overcome the evil one, to endure the persecution of our families and friends who don't understand our coming to Christ. Help them, Lord, to continue to pray for our loved ones as well, as there may be husbands and wives, there may be fathers and mothers, there may be children and relatives that have not yet been able to discover the forgiveness and the love and the joy that can be had in Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, for tearing the idols from our hearts and replacing them with a vision shared by your word of an eternity that we will have to spend together rejoicing because those who loved sent and those who were obedient came. Thank you for sending the Myers to us. And for those who suffer behind in their absence, help them to know too that we're praying for them in their time of pain and grief, but help them to know too that they're multiplying their lives in the lives of those of us who have never heard. Bring us close together, we pray, that God would be glorified in a way that would cause those within our community to seek to know the reason for the hope that is within us. In Christ Jesus, we pray.
Concluding this commissioning, I'd like to offer at this time a song that reminds us of the reason for such a commissioning. Listen to the words. Let them speak to your heart as they call not only Stan and Mindy, but each of us to our purpose for being.
I can see it in their eyes, empty people filled with care, headed who knows where. On they go through private pain, living Jesus hears.
Our gracious God and Father, we conclude this day of celebration, this day of solemn covenanting with one another, and we covenant by your grace further to be in the center of your will, along with Stan and with Mindy, to seek to meet them with their needs, the greatest need of all, the Lord Jesus, and to share him in his love. Watch over Stan and Mindy, Lord. Bless them in every way. And watch over us, Lord, because we need you too. And help us to bring a myriad of others into the circle of your love. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here today. Amen.